Dear colleagues, the topic integration or teamwork starts at the point when we have to start thinking. After finishing of the evaluation of a nodular goiter patient, there are three possibilities. The first and least frequent is that the patient has a suspicious Bethesda 5 or definitively malignant nodule. We are generously moving on the problem that more and more people are formulating a recommendation that papillary cancers should be treated differently based on the size of the nodule and the age of the patient. Here, put it simply, we say that Bethesda 5 and 6 nodules require surgery. It now gives us enough ammunition to deal with the other two situations. Cytological examination is unclear in a quarter to a third of patients. Of course, there are recommendations for these situations, but basically we have to make individual decisions here, similar to when the nodule proves to be benign. In this presentation, we discuss the latter two clinical situations with respect to the role of ultrasound. The introductory lectures of this section include another presentation which discusses a new approach in the event of follicular tumors. In this lecture, I will shortly remind you of the role of ultrasound in relation to the algorithm used for evaluation of nodular goiter patients. This has been already discussed in the introductory video presentation of the second chapter. Thereafter, I will talk about the possible role of ultrasound after the cytological examination. I will present about some ultrasound patterns which can influence the decision even after a cytological report. Finally, I will discuss those clinical situations in which the ultrasound has a privileged role. So, into the midst of the things, here is a matter of questions. Does the analysis of the ultrasound presentation of a nodule have any meanings in the indication of FNA? In the context of indication of cytology, is there any benefit to patients if the investigator has thoroughly analyzed the characteristics of the nodule? Basically, there are two approaches. The first is the old-fashioned one, which targets to discover all thyroid malignancies larger than 1 cm in diameter. In other words, the goal of this approach is to reach the ideal sensitivity at the cost of a low specificity. And secondly, the newer approach backed by old thyroids, which tries to balance between an optimal sensitivity and optimal specificity and denotes that some thyroid cancers larger than 1 cm are not recognized. I do not want to go deeper in the advantages and disadvantages of the two approaches now. Here I would just like to draw attention to the fact that in the case of older approach, the ultrasound features discussed earlier have very limited role in terms of the cytological indication. If one thinks that applying the newer suggestions is risky and it is worth performing FNA in every nodule larger than 1 cm, it has seemingly wasted time studying the previous chapters. In other words, if we write all nodules larger than 1 cm into the black box, the indication of FNA is not influenced by the ultrasound pattern, the size of the nodule is the only feature which affects our decision. So was the time wasted? No, surely not. Indeed, reviewing the previous chapters were essential. This is because ultrasound and ultrasound characteristics are used for purposes other than selection of patients for cytology. Let's compare two different worlds. A guideline necessarily supposes ideal conditions and cannot deal with conditions which differ from one evaluation group to another. The second statement written in the table is more problematic. Essentially, most guidelines pretend as to ultrasound would have role only before FNA and if its role would be restricted for selection of nodules for FNA. In the real world, conditions are often not ideal. I've been doing cytology for more than 30 years, but it's extremely hard to get patients to take it 6 passes during FNA as some guidelines suggest. Occasionally, there are patients who refuse the aspiration. Second, some nodules behave as very lazy students and do not read the guidelines. Therefore, they behave inappropriately. Third, and most importantly, the professional conditions are in most cases not ideal. As I will present, the FNA has significant limitations. Moreover, the personal conditions in an evaluation team can be problematic. In the upcoming part of the lecture, I will focus on the highlighted condition only. The main issues are presented here. In a significant proportion of cases, the cytological result is inconclusive and the diagnostic sensitivity of FNA cannot be higher than 90-95%, which means that in every 10th to every 20th of cancers, the FNA is false negative. Considering the non-diagnostic cytological reports, the ratio of unrecognized cancers is even higher, surely above 10%, even supposing the best conditions. The clinician should always be aware that FNA can fail. At this point, the importance of ultrasound features really comes to the fore. It would be sufficient to measure the nodules only if the features are not relevant in the cytological indication. But the only chance for the patients to reduce the disadvantage caused by a false negative and a non-diagnostic cytological finding is to consider the appearance of the nodule in further management. Second, the conditions are not always ideal. In a tertiary care unit, the cytological examination should be available whenever necessary and the cytopathologist should be expected to have appropriate practice. It is evident that these requirements are not fulfilled in each European tertiary care unit. The situation is surely worse in lower levels of care, where patients are usually referred for thyroid examination. It means that we may not be able to achieve the goal to recognize all thyroid cancers in nodules larger than 1 cm in diameter if the availability of cytological examination is limited. The patient may have a legitimate need to provide some estimate of tumor risk based on the ultrasound image. If the results of FNA are available within an acceptably short period, within 1 or 2 days, then we can reject this request. But in many cases, it takes a considerably longer time for the cytological finding to be made. I will talk about the role of ultrasound, about the reconsideration of ultrasound in relation to the cytological results. The first problem arises when the FNA is repeatedly non-diagnostic. Let's compare the two cases. The hypoechoic nodule in the left images presents non-parallel orientation and has irregular lobulated margins. This is a very suspicious nodule. In contrast, the risk of malignancy in the right nodule is significantly lower than the average. Two patients, both with a non-diagnostic cytological report. It is evident that we have to say it quite differently to the patient on the left than the patient on the right. And our judgment is based on the reconsideration of the ultrasound. The second inconclusive type of cytological results is the Bethesda 3 category. The atypia or follicular proliferation of unknown significance. I present here again two opposite examples. The risk of malignancy in the left case is average or at most a bit higher than the average. In contrast, the right nodule is very suspicious mainly because of the very irregular lobulated margins and of the multiple microcalcifications. The next and final inconclusive FNA diagnosis is the Bethesda 4 category, either the follicular tumor or the suspicion of follicular tumor. The ultrasound may play an even more important but neglected role in follicular lesions. I have already mentioned this opportunity and the next lecture is devoted to this. I present here only two examples. The cytology was follicular tumor in both cases. However, the risk of follicular tumor is extremely different in these examples. The risk is more than 95% in the left case, by less than 5% in the right one. A follicular tumor must have a capsule. The ultrasound signs of this are the halo and the perinodular vascularity. With very few exceptions, all follicular tumors show one or both of these signs. It means that the right nodule is unlikely to be a follicular tumor despite the cytological report. This table presents the occurrence of inconclusive FNA diagnosis. I only mention that lesions suspicious of malignancy other than follicular cancer are not included among inconclusive FNA findings. Roughly one-third of all cytologies give ambiguous results. These are the cases where after the investigation we have to make an individual decision by integrating the available data. Guidelines suggest what may be the best decision in the average case, but in reality, each such patient requires an individual decision. Naturally, not only the ultrasound presentation, but the age of the patient, the palpation of the lesion, the progression of the nodule are also among data which must be taken into account. Nevertheless, the ultrasound presentation is the most important among them. And now maybe I frustrate the listener, but I will not be able to make a formalized tabular proposal. We can help with integration, but this process can become more mature and more grounded only with practice. This course with nearly 1,000 of videos can help the less experienced to move forward in the integration process. If there is a way for this to help us, it is to look in depth at not more than 20 to 40 cases a week with the accompanying videos, some of them even several times. After this detour, I present another classification of data. These data present the risk of malignancy in patients with non-diagnostic and benign cytological results. This 2 to 5% rate can be considered as a lot or little. It can be pushed even a little lower by an experienced cytologist, and it can be higher by a less experienced one. But we cannot neglect this possibility. The consideration or reconsideration of ultrasound has a third possible role. On the one hand, this can help the patient. There is a significant difference between the times and the time it takes for the cytological examination to take place, and the time it takes to complete the finding. This ranges from 30 minutes in the event of on-site cytology to several weeks. As a rule of thumb, the average risk of malignancy is around 3 to 5% in a nodule, and the risk that the nodule can shorten the life expectancy is around 1 in 1,000. We should inform the patient about these risks. Firstly, because almost all patients feel these risks much higher in the event of thyroid nodule. We can stratify these average risks if we take the ultrasound presentation into account. The risk that the nodule can shorten the life expectancy is practically zero in the two left and in the upper right nodules. Although papillary cancer cannot be excluded in the left upper case, the size of the nodule is less than 1 cm, so in the worst case this will be a papillary microcancer. The risk of malignancy is significantly higher in the right lower nodule, and as a worst case this will be not a well differentiated but a medullary cancer. So in this patient the risk of malignancy is around 10 to 20%, but the risk that this nodule will lead to a shortened life expectancy is around 0.5%. Finally, a few thoughts about organizational issues. Each investigative team has a different practice. At the same time, a critical point significantly determines the turnover of the unit. And that is, examining a single patient requires two appearances or just one. In most cases, an experienced investigator can give a very accurate estimate of what can be expected from cytology. With two or three informative sentences at the end of the visit, you can save another person a look. This saves an unnecessary visit, which is important both for the patient and the investigator. To summarize this previous part of the presentation, if we went through the suggestions of the algorithm, it is a mistake to believe that we got the clear solution in each case. Unfortunately not. In fact, in a lot of cases, we have to start thinking here. As I have presented, in up to one-third of patients, the situation is not clear after the patient went through the process. The quality of the decisions in these 20 to 35% of patients defines the quality of the evaluation team. We should overview all possible data. Reviewing and reanalyzing the aggregated data is the main tool for the decision, and one of the most important data is the ultrasound pattern. One more consideration. We always focus on thyroid malignancy, but be aware that suspicion of malignancy is only one of the possible surgical indications. The second, the hyperthyroid goiter, is quite a simple task. However, the most common cause of surgery is the euthyroid goiter, at least in Europe. Most borderline cases occur here, and in fact, it is not 20 to 30% of patients, but a much higher proportion that after the steps of the investigation, we need to think. I use the same term, risk stratification, as thyroids to group the nodes. But it must be absolutely clear at this point of the course, this is not about thyroids. The most suspicious thyroids group 5 includes nodules with a slightly higher risk of malignancy than an average nodule. It is clear that thyroids is not a substitute for cytology. For most thyroids 5 category nodules, it should be accepted if the cytology is negative. And for most thyroids 5 category nodules, it is not acceptable to suggest surgery for an inconclusive cytology. However, there are some outstanding ultrasound patterns where we might want to think differently. So once again, I will talk about the aristocracy of suspicious characteristics. For the sake of take-home message, I highlight some examples where the risk is significantly higher compared to otherwise also suspicious signs. The first and most important pattern affects microcalcification. Two specific patterns are worth mentioning, the so-called starry sky phenomenon and the ultrasound presentation suggestive of invasive spread. It is crucial to recognize these patterns because despite the negative cytology, the risk of papillary cancer is much higher than 50% in such presentations. The importance of this is underlined by the fact that in contrast to many other suspicious patterns, the possibility of thyroiditis arises with a low probability. Many active foci of thyroiditis can present irregular borders or non-parallel orientation, and in the differentiation of true nodule from more active foci of thyroiditis, the deep hypocalcogenicity has no role, but a discrete lesion showing numerous microcalcifications is only exceptionally a focus of thyroiditis. So, let's see four examples. The left upper nodule has numerous microcalcifications, the borders are specifically irregular, moreover the lesion is suspicious spreading extrathyroidal. The left lower nodule presents the so-called starry sky phenomenon, the borders of the lesion cannot be judged. The borders of the right upper lesion are again indistinctive. Moreover, the presence of a few microcalcifications in a distance from the primary focus raises the possibility of invasive spread or multifocality. The right lower lesion shows starry sky phenomenon, which means that the lesion contains numerous microcalcifications in a disarranged distribution. The second pattern worth highlighting is the presence of suspicious lymph nodes. This was discussed in a distinct chapter, but has to be mentioned here. there are different degrees of suspicion. The pattern demonstrated in the left images is very suspicious because of the lack of regular hilum, the irregular shape and the microcalcifications. The presentation of the right node is again almost itself diagnostic. It lacks hilum but has cystic content, microcalcification and the less hypoechoic solid part. In my opinion, these are the four patterns when a cytological examination can rarely be so reassuring that surgery is not recommended. The next ultrasound presentation is much less frequent compared with the formerly mentioned types. A nodule with abutting and bulging contours should raise the possibility of cancer either with or without a rear extrathyroidal spread. Unfortunately, many benign lesions show the ultrasound signs of a possible extrathyroidal extension, the abutting and bulging contours. I try to present the striking difference between nodules showing ultrasound signs of extrathyroidal extension. Although both nodules show abutting and bulging contours, these are presentations of two different worlds. The degree of bulging is much higher in the left case compared with the right one. Even more important is the presentation of the ventral borders, which is irregular in the left while regular in the right nodule. There are several other non-classifiable examples which we meet occasionally. I present two cases. The left nodule has numerous microcalcifications and irregular lobulated and blurred borders. The right one shows non-parallel orientation, irregular borders and is very suspicious spreading extrathyroidal. By no means can I say that such patterns, regardless of cytology, require surgery in all cases. Rather, I suggest the approach that in the case of such a pattern, surgery can only be disregarded if at different times occasionally a cytological sample taken from 4 to 6 sides of the nodule is clearly reassuring. The final example has been mentioned even in this presentation. This is a very simple consideration and requires a good and reliable quality of both ultrasound and cytology. We can exclude the presence of follicular tumor if a nodule does not present either a halo or perinodular blood flow. The other important condition is partly cytologist dependent. A papillary cancer can be misinterpreted as a follicular tumor. This misinterpretation rate can be significantly reduced with due care. Now I move on the last theme. There are other situations in which the ultrasound plays less important but existing role. These are enlisted in the table. These are conditions in which a combined clinical and ultrasound approach can lead to the right decision. In other words, these examples highlight the importance of a good level of cooperation between the radiologist and the clinician. Although the first two cases do not belong to the topic of nodular goiters, I think it is worth mentioning here them. The first is a very simple fact. The likelihood of a severe hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism is very low in sonographically intact thyroids. The specificity of leading clinical symptoms of a thyroid dysfunction is very low. So if a patient suffers from complaints suggesting thyroid dysfunction but presents with a normal ultrasound pattern, we can say with great certainty that the cause of complaints is elsewhere. Of course, hormone determination is crucial, but it has practical significance, the above finding in those for whom a blood test result is not yet available. There is a special form of this situation. This is a very rare case, we meet this one in several thousand patients. Laboratory tests disclosed significant thyroid dysfunction, but the ultrasound discloses an intact econormal thyroid. In such cases, it is quite likely that some laboratory errors have occurred, whether it is a technical problem or a human failure, For example, the exchange of samples of two people. I emphasize here two conditions. The dysfunction should be severe and the ultrasound pattern should be completely regular. An isolated abnormal FT3 level, which is a frequent finding in healthy thyroid, does not belong to this category. I talk about this situation when the FT4 value is at least double the upper limit. I can tell you the exact details. In the last 17 years, 14 such cases have occurred in my practice. In 10 of these cases, the blood result was erroneous, while in 4 cases, the ultrasound was misleading. The second example also relies on hyperthyroidism. It asks the possible differential diagnostic role of ultrasound. We meet the second type in hyperthyroid patients in whom the vascularity is decreased. The situation is illustrated with 4 images of a patient. This pattern, the decreased vascularity, strongly suggests that the elevated FT4 level is caused by self-destruction, thyroiditis, and not by overproduction of Graves' disease. This observation influences the treatment of the patient. Either we recommend monitoring instead of administering thyrostatic treatment, or we recommend a lower dose of drug or prescribe more frequent monitoring. The next example comes from the everyday practice and is rarely mentioned in the literature. It is not uncommon to meet a patient who has been referred to evaluation of a goiter detected on a chest X-ray. Experience shows that as the age progresses, the thyroid gland descends slightly and seems to spread substernal in an increasing proportion of those over 60 years. The lower pole could be visualized in neither lobe. However, the thyroid was not enlarged and the lower pores became visible during swallowing. The fourth example has been already mentioned, but it is worth mentioning once more again. In a patient with a euthyroid benign nodular goiter, not the size of the nodule, but the size of the lobe decides whether surgery is indicated or not. Moreover, the location of the thyroid gland and the patient's body size also influence the decision. For example, higher the location of the thyroid, larger the size causing compression signs. I think that in contrast to a formalized decision, taking all circumstances into account can only lead to a more justified decision. This patient had a nodule with a maximal diameter of 53 mm. Although it was really a large nodule, it caused only minimal, if any, enlargement of the nodular lobe. So again, not the size of the nodule, but the size of the nodular lobe is the crucial data in indicating surgery in benign euthyroid goiter. The final example relies on patients in whom the surgical indication is obvious because of compression signs. The question is whether to perform lobectomy or remove also the other lobe, which itself would not be candidate of surgery. There is no question that the right lobe should be removed because it is extremely enlarged and caused compression signs. The left lobe also has nodules, but it is not obvious whether we should suggest removing this lobe too. Our suggestion whether to perform thyroidectomy or only lobectomy depends on some factors, mostly on the age of the patient and on the size of the lobe in question. How to summarize this topic? I think that one of the main messages of this lecture is the potential of ultrasound to use not only for selecting nodule for FNA. This is not only a possibility, it is a necessity. In great proportion, up to the third of patients underwent FNA, the results are inconclusive. Ultrasound is our greatest help to make a good decision. There are several ultrasound patterns in which we may need to deviate from the proposal of the algorithm. There are quite much clinical situations in which the results of ultrasound should be involved to our proposal. This does not only apply to nodular goiter patients. I apologize to those I may have deceived and believed that by listening to this lecture or completing the course they would be able to integrate each ultrasound feature. Indeed, integration is an ability to be continuously developed. The basis is the practice with performing ultrasound examination or gain experience with systematical involvement of ultrasound results in our clinical decision. I mean that the main contribution of this course is not the theoretical foundation, but the possibility to analyze collection of case studies with ultrasound videos. Thank you very much for your attention.